Hi everyone and welcome back to my channel. So my husband this morning posted something on my wall. There was an outbreak of measles in Portland and that got me a little riled. That along with like all of the celebrity anti-vax nonsense. If you're anti-vax, please just stick with me in this video before you make comments because, you know, you got to know what I'm saying before you can comment on it. And I'm absolutely willing to look at your research. I'm absolutely willing to look at any piece of information that you have that supports your point. And I have a lot of resources that I've pulled from, and I'm obviously willing to look at other resources because I am a resource whore. You can't monetize that. So over the last 15 years or so, we've seen an uptick in parents who are unwilling to vaccinate their children for various reasons, some being the chemicals that are present in vaccinations, some being the vaccination schedule and their concern that it maybe overloads the immune system of the child, and then some being a non-realistic link to autism and the MMR vaccine specifically. So today we're going to be talking about what vaccinations do, what they don't do, what's in them, and why these things are in them. And we're also going to talk about some of the diseases that they prevent and why we need them to be prevented and why we made vaccinations in the first place. So if you're interested in that, stick around. We'll be right back. So right off the bat, I want to say that vaccines do not cause autism. This has been proven time and time again, and the man that mainly spearheaded the anti-vax movement in the late 90s, he has been released from his ability to practice medicine. Basically, he's infamous at this point, so you can't really trust anything that he has to say. So the big thing that a lot of people say and their tagline is that Big Pharma wants to keep you sick and that vaccines don't really do anything, and if they do anything, they maybe cause harm to the people that receive the vaccinations. But what I think is interesting about this is the man that was responsible for that infamous study about vaccinations and autism, he released a book at the same time. He released some snake oil cures. So he was making money off of shilling this information that was dangerous to the public at large. I think when we're talking about Big Pharma, we need to be very careful about who all we're lumping in with that. Because behind vaccinations, yes, are pharmaceutical companies, but also scientists and everyday people who want you to be healthy and who want their families to be healthy. And I think it's really cynical and somehow cynical and optimistic to think that, you know, scientists and politicians and pharmaceutical companies all over the world would be in on this like big scheme to make all humans sick and to make all humans have autism just to get money. Like, it's, I don't believe that people work together that well, but that's just me. So obviously, vaccines do not cause autism. We already know this. This has been proven time and time again. There have been large-scale studies on the efficacy and safety of all the vaccinations that we use today. So there really aren't any mysteries as far as reactions to vaccinations, as far as whether or not they're effective, as far as whether or not they're dangerous for people. There are no mysteries here. We've been studying these since we've had them, and we've done large-scale studies that have proven that vaccinations, by and large, are not harmful to human beings. They're helpful. But what really bothers me is the idea that to avoid having an autistic child, you would put them at risk to contract communicable diseases that could potentially be fatal or potentially be life-altering. Just to avoid having a child with autism. That to me is cruel, incredibly cruel. And I don't think that people think of it that way. And I don't think that people who are anti-vax are cruel people. I think they're just incredibly misinformed and they're scared of what they don't understand. Not to mention the fact that people who are autistic have so many options now. There's early intervention, there's early therapies that make their life so much easier and that give them the resources that they need to be successful. And I work with so many autistic people, and they're empathic, they're funny, you know, they're normal people that just are neuroatypical. And I think it's important to really consider if you are opening your child up to potential death just to avoid having a child with autism. You have to really consider what that means for your view of people with autism. That's all besides the point, because obviously vaccinations do not cause autism. They just don't. There are a whole bunch of things that we'll get into that could be the cause of autism, but vaccination is 100% not one of them. The other thing to mention is with the concern about autism rates rising, it's really less about there being more autism and more about our understanding of autism and our ability to diagnose it. So there have always been autistic people. It's just that in the past, we assumed that there was nothing to be done with them and we just shoved them into mental hospitals. And that was cruel beyond measure. And thankfully, we don't do that anymore to our citizens, or we try not to do it anymore to our citizens. But the science of psychology, genetics, all of that is pretty young. It's in its infancy as far as like what we are able to understand. So it makes sense that our ability to diagnose a very complex syndrome such as autism and something that is on a scale is in its early days. So we have to accept that we're going to see more autism, but it doesn't necessarily mean that there are more people who are autistic. The other thing to mention is that parents typically notice signs of autism around 12 to 18 months of age, and that is coincidentally when the first MMR vaccine is administered. So the signs actually begin much earlier, but that's just when the parents start to notice a slight regression in the child's formally attained abilities. It has even been proven that regular and early MRIs can predict autism in high-risk children. And that allows parents to begin therapies much earlier so that they're more effective. So scientists haven't exactly nailed down what causes autism, but there are some defined commonalities that seem likely, including exposure to toxins and viruses in utero, genetic components, and even an increased number of synapses in the brain causing the brain to kind of misfire and miscommunicate. So in case you don't get what I just said there, I'm basically saying that parents and doctors are in no way responsible for causing their child's autism. It's not really something that you can control. So you're not making your babies autistic by not reading to them enough, by giving them GMO corn, by vaccinating them. You're doing your best, mama. Don't you worry. So as far as the Kat Von D thing, it seemed to me that her concern was more about gelatin being used in some of the vaccinations. I totally get not wanting to cause more harm to animals and not wanting to feed into that system of factory farming, because it is repulsive and disturbing, to say the least. When you consider the long-term ramifications of your not vaccinating your children, you're causing more harm than you're doing good. So yes, you have saved, you know, a small amount of gelatin from being used for your child in particular. So if your 8-year-old decides to give a hug and a kiss to their friend's new sibling, little baby brother, and they have measles that's incubating, but it hasn't actually shown up yet, they could end up giving measles to that baby, and that baby could end up with encephalitis, could end up with meningitis, or could die. That is something that happens when babies get these common illnesses that other people tend to bounce back from. It's not just about babies and young children who can't be vaccinated. It's about people with illnesses that make them immunocompromised. It's about the elderly. There are a whole bunch of people who cannot be vaccinated, and they rely on us, the healthy people, to be vaccinated. Is it more cruel to your population to not vaccinate and potentially bring back common illnesses that can kill people or even impact their life greatly? Or is it more cruel to have 2 or 3 shots that happen to have gelatin in them? You really have to consider this, because it's not just a matter of one type of cruelty, it's several different kinds of cruelty. And it's important to consider that when you're making your decisions. So a lot of anti-vaxxers talk about herd immunity as though that is a thing that's a given for any community of people, but herd immunity depends on everyone who's healthy getting their vaccinations, and that protects the people who cannot be vaccinated or who are too young to be vaccinated. So when people say, well, if you have your vaccinations, why are you so worried? It's like, we're not worried about us. We're worried about people who cannot be vaccinated, people who are too young. Like, do you want to be the cause of a baby dying or a baby getting encephalitis and potentially being mentally handicapped for the rest of their life? You're not just choosing for your family, you're choosing for your entire community. It's also important to remember that common childhood illnesses, things that you and I probably got when we were children, are deadly for some children.
Take a breath, Melanie. Come on. Almost there. There we go. Oh my. It's okay. It's okay.
Yeah. When I contracted chickenpox before the vaccine was available, I was 3 and I ended up in the hospital for severe pneumonia. Now, if you had talked to my mother at that point and said, you know, would you be open to her having a vaccination for chickenpox? She would have said, absolutely yes. Nobody wants to see their toddler in the hospital. I could have been irreparably damaged by that event. So even something as simple as chickenpox, something that most of us older people got when we were children, can be deadly for people, and that can be deadly for adults who are not able to be vaccinated. Also, when I was in my early 20s, I didn't have healthcare and I let my vaccinations lapse and I contracted mumps. So I was deathly ill for about a week with a very high fever to the point where I was basically being watched so that if it got too high, I wouldn't have a stroke or something. They would just take me to the hospital. And I was sick for about a month. I had horrible throat pain. I could barely talk. I could barely hear. And I did end up losing some of the hearing in my right ear, which is, you know, I'm happy for it because for a while I could barely hear out of either ear. So I was really happy to get my hearing back to a large degree. You know, I'm really lucky with my outcome, and mumps tends to be easier for children than it is for adults, but still, why would you want to have mumps if you don't have to? It's horrible, and there's a lot that can go wrong with it. I could have been deaf for the rest of my life. So at this point, I'd like to talk about the MMR vaccine, which seems to get the most ire from anti-vaxxers because of its association with that paper that Andrew Wakefield made about autism and the MMR vaccine that was widely discredited by like real scientists, not by shill doctors. And I'd like to talk about the morbidity and mortality rates of these specific illnesses. Measles remains the leading cause of infant death worldwide. Let that sink in. Measles can kill very young babies who cannot get the vaccine. And here are just a few statistics about measles before the 1963 development of the vaccination. And I'm reading this off of a computer, by the way. So each year, measles caused an estimated 3 to 4 million cases. Close to 500,000 cases were reported annually to CDC, resulting in 48,000 hospitalizations, 4,000 cases with encephalitis, which is swelling of the brain, which can be deadly or it can leave you brain damaged, and 450 to 500 deaths. Okay, so in the US, the rate for hospitalization is 1 out of every 4 cases. The rate for encephalitis is 1 out of every 1,000 people. The rate of death is 1 to 2 per 1,000 cases. Complications are more common in children under 5 and adults above 20. Common complications include ear infections, diarrhea, and these ear infections can occur in about 1 out of every 10 patients, and they can lead to permanent hearing loss. There are some severe complications, including pneumonia, encephalitis, and at that point, people will usually need to be hospitalized, and they have a higher risk of mortality. Rubella is an acute contagious viral infection, and it usually only causes a mild fever and a rash in children children and adults. But if someone contracts rubella during their pregnancy, especially during the first trimester, it can lead to miscarriage, fetal death, stillbirth, or infants with severe malformations. And this is known as congenital rubella syndrome. Children with CGS, or congenital rubella syndrome, can end up with deafness, with blindness, they can have autism, they can have diabetes mellitus, thyroid dysfunction, and all of these things, in case you don't know, would be incredibly expensive to treat. This would require a lot of support, a lot of money for these parents to then be able to raise their children properly. Before the introduction of the MMR vaccine, up to 4 out of every 1,000 births would end up with a child with CGS. So the World Health Organization has suggested that rubella could be completely eradicated by 2020. I hope that is still the case, even with the anti-vax movement going on, but we'll see. Cross your fingers for that, because that sounds scary as hell. Now let's talk about mumps. So mumps is usually not that bad for children. It can lead to complications, and the complications are not rare, but in general, it's just really uncomfortable and not fun for the person who has it. So the complications include meningitis, testicular inflammation that can cause atrophy in the testicles and even affect your ability to have children, inflammation of the ovaries or breasts in females who have reached puberty, which that sounds awful. Before the development of the vaccine, this disease was one of the major causes of deafness in children. And I think it's really important to remember these things because we don't see mumps very often anymore. So we don't really have a good idea of what it's like for children and adults who contract it. So a lot of parents are really concerned with the chemicals that go into vaccinations. And I totally get it. This sounds scary. If you look at your darling, beautiful new little baby and you watch them get poked with needles, it's gonna scare you. And if you read just the names of what's going into it, it's terrifying if you don't understand exactly how much is going in, how much is already present in our body just naturally, and what it's used for, and sometimes even whether or not it's filtered out of the end process, because that also happens. So I'm gonna dive into the most common concerns for people and tell you why you really should not be that concerned with it. And let's also talk about the word chemicals, because a lot of people use the word chemicals to create this fear response in people, because chemicals sound unnatural. It sounds like something that shouldn't be in your body, shouldn't be in your food, shouldn't be in your medicine, but you are literally made of chemicals. Everything in the world has chemicals in it. Water is a couple of types of chemicals smashed together. So you really can't avoid chemicals in anything. And I think it's important to acknowledge that chemicals are not the enemy, and that the word toxins is kind of thrown around very liberally. So let's start off with thimerosal. Thimerosal is ethyl mercury. I know that everyone knows mercury is present in many different kinds of seafoods, some in trace, some in larger amounts. It's just something that we naturally get in our system, whether we are thinking about it or not. Because of the uproar and the anti-vax movement, only the influenza and tetanus vaccinations even include ethyl mercury anymore. Thimerosal is used as a preservative, and it is completely safe in the small amounts that it is used. All right, and the second one is formaldehyde. When anyone thinks formaldehyde, you think, that's what we put in dead people. And yes, that is. But it's also a preservative that is already naturally present in your body. Formaldehyde is already present in the body to help the metabolic system. It can be toxic in large quantities, obviously, but the majority of it is already filtered out by the end result of the vaccination. And this is a really interesting piece of information that I think kind of frames it in a way that most people will understand. The highest amount of formaldehyde present in any vaccination is 0.02 milligrams per dose. The average 2-month-old baby would have about 1.1 milligrams of formaldehyde circulating in their body already. The next one is aluminum. So aluminum boosts your immune system's response, so you need less of the inactive virus to get a stronger response. Furthermore, aluminum is naturally found in lots of things in nature, including the water that you drink. It's in breast milk. You can't avoid aluminum. And in the trace amounts that are in a vaccination, it's completely harmless. A breastfed infant will consume around 7 milligrams of aluminum in the first 6 months of life without any vaccination. vaccinations, and the amount of aluminum in a single vaccination does not noticeably raise the aluminum content in the bloodstream, so it is perfectly safe. The next thing we'll talk about is antibiotics. So I am not all about antibiotics being used for anything and everything. We've got a lot of super bugs because of our overzealous use of antibiotics in the past. However, the small amount of antibiotics used in vaccinations help with the risk of bacterial infections. So it is entirely worth it to have them in your vaccine. Some children do have allergic responses to antibiotics in general, but no allergic response in a child that has had a vaccination has ever been traced back to the antibiotic. Furthermore, at the end of the purification process for the vaccine, almost all of the antibiotic is removed, leaving only trace amounts. You're not getting any noticeable amounts of antibiotic in your system if you choose to vaccinate. So the next one is the reason Kat Von D said that she plans to not vaccinate her child, and that is gelatin. So gelatin is a stabilizer, and it is the single largest identifiable source of allergic reactions to vaccinations. Still, only 1 in 2 million injections is at risk for that allergic reaction, so it's relatively safe. And that's generally why, you know, when you take your kid to the doctor's office to get that first big injection, that they have you stick around for about 30 minutes to make sure that everything is okay at the end of the day. That being said, you can absolutely receive medical exemption if you have a gelatin allergy, and that's something to talk about with your doctor to see if your allergic reaction is going to be big enough to that vaccination to warrant not getting it. The next thing that's used is monosodium glutamate, or MSG. So MSG is used as a preservative to keep vaccines stable throughout their shelf life. And MSG has gotten a really, really bad rap from people of causing all sorts of horrible inflammation and, you know, anaphylactic shock and stuff like that. But there really is no evidence that MSG causes severe reactions in people. Some people do have mild allergic reactions to MSG, such as myself. I generally, my tongue gets a little bit itchy and my lips swell up a little bit, but it's not enough to keep me from eating food that has MSG in it. It's just like I get a little bit of a boost in my lip volume. That works for me. But what's interesting is because of the outrage of MSG being included in any vaccination, it has been removed from all vaccinations except influenza and adenovirus. So if you're getting any garden variety vaccination other than those two, it doesn't have MSG in it. I'd like to also discuss the false narrative of vaccines disrupting the immune system of the children who receive them, and that being tied to alternative vaccination scheduling. So with the current schedule, children may receive up to 24 vaccinations by the age of 2, with up to 5 pokes in a single visit. But the big thing to note here is that because of technological advances and advances in medicine, your children are actually receiving less antigens than they were at any other point in time. So you need less antigens to do the same job, and the antigens are the components of vaccines that stimulate the immune response to the viruses. And this is also something that I read that I thought was really, really interesting and fascinating. Because of the prevalence of different types of diseases in different areas, most countries have a different vaccination schedule, where they prioritize certain vaccines over other ones. And this is usually used to signal a lack of evidence-based science when it comes to the scheduling of vaccinations, but really it's mainly about different viruses being more prevalent in other parts of the world. So you're gonna vaccinate for the things that are closer to home and then push off some of the other things if you can. And to round all of this out, I want to talk about the responsibility of celebrity in pushing the anti-vax movement and how I feel there is kind of a tie to what we see in the media and what we see in our communities. Whether we like it or not, people follow celebrities and people look up to them and respect what they have to say about things. And it's not that they have more access and more insight to conspiracy theories in the field. And I'm not here to say that all celebrities are fear-mongering. I don't think that it's that simple. I feel like people genuinely don't understand the science, they don't understand the chemicals that are used, and they get scared, and that's completely natural and logical. But then the reaction past that has to be to do the research, and that's where people kind of misstep. They look at a celebrity and they say, hey, this person is talking about this. I'm gonna go ahead and, you know, take their word for it. I'm not going to look into it because it doesn't really matter. I'm going to use the information that they're pointing me to, and I'm not going to look for sources that say otherwise. And that is so important. You have to research your point of view, the other point of view, and you have to try to find the truth within it. And sometimes the truth is not going to be your point of view. And I certainly have had lots of things that I've researched that I've started off thinking of it in one light, and then during the research thought, oh, okay, well, I was completely wrong. And you know, whether we like it or not, people are going to talk about what they believe in, and some of those people happen to be celebrities, and when they talk about what they believe in, there are people who look up to them and who are going to follow them. And we're not really going to be able to change that paradigm. There are always going to be people who want to follow celebrities. There are always going to be people who don't necessarily choose to do the research for themselves, even though one would hope that with all the access to the information on this like amazing little box that everyone has, that they'd be able to see when something is BS and when it's not. You just can't necessarily trust that people are going to do that. And it's not that they're stupid. It's not that they're lazy. It's that something resonates with them and they don't feel the need to fact check it. We're all guilty of this to some degree. So I think it's important not to bash people who are anti-vax because they're doing what they think is best. It's important to be kind to them, but be firm with the fact that their anti-vax stance is not based in any sort of reality. And in fact, it is dangerous for the community. So you don't have to be mean to people to express to someone that what they're doing is not based in fact and is harmful. As far as government being able to regulate who is allowed to be exempt from vaccinations and who isn't, I would love to be able to say parents can be completely responsible for their child's health, and they should be. But unfortunately, there are a lot of people that act without proof and act on faith that something that they read on an article on Infowars.com is 100% correct. And unfortunately, we can't really trust people to know all of the medical and vaccine science. You just can't. And when it comes to you having that autonomy over raising your child versus you having the autonomy of raising your child and also being able to then give, you know, communicable diseases to other children who can't be vaccinated and then who could die or be irrevocably harmed, we have to kind of draw a line in the sand at some point and say, you know, you have to be vaccinated. And it sucks because I feel like people should have the ability to just do whatever they want. But at the same time, when you're harming your children, when you're harming not just your children, but other people's children, that's when people have to step in. I don't mean to throw in the anti-vaxxers to the people who refuse medical treatment for their children, whose children then die. Like, I'm not making that, you know, that pairing together because I think that's absurd. But there is kind of a commonality of the mental process behind it, of not trusting medicine, not trusting doctors, of chemicals being bad, of everything being a toxin if you can't pronounce it. We have to protect children against that because there are so many children who get sick, who die, because their parents are scared of science. And at this point, we're not going to be able to educate everybody on what the science is and why it's important. So we have to protect the kids first and then work on educating everybody. But it's gonna be a process, and hopefully at some point we won't have to force people to vaccinate their children and to send them to doctors if they're very sick. But at this point, we kind of have to force it. Another thing that I think is really important to mention is that anti-vax is not new. Since we've had vaccinations, or even earlier, since we had inoculations, people have been against them. It's completely sensical to look at something that you don't understand and be like, I'm not gonna touch it. Like, biologically, it makes sense that if you don't understand it, then you're gonna kind of stay away from it. And that's kind of why I decided to make this video, is that I don't want people to be scared of common chemicals that they can already find in their body without the vaccinations. I don't want people to be scared of the immunization schedule because it doesn't do anything wrong to the immune system. I don't want people to think that the MMR vaccine causes autism. And I feel like we can really support parents in making educated decisions about their children's health and not falling into the trap of fake news. This is a quote by Benjamin Franklin. In 1736, I lost one of my sons, a fine boy of 4 years old, by the smallpox taken in the common way. I long regretted bitterly and still regret that I had not given it to him by inoculation. This I mention for the sake of parents who omit that operation on the supposition that they should never forgive themselves if a child died under it. My example showing that the regret may be the same either way and that therefore the safer should be chosen. So at that time, the smallpox inoculation was a little intense. So they had to lance open the skin of the healthy person. They would put a scab or some pus from an infected person in that and then sew it up. And that's how you were inoculated. So thank God that's not a thing anymore, because I would severely vom all over my arm. So the thing is that this actually gave the person smallpox, but that the smallpox that they got from the inoculation was a lot more manageable, because they were essentially getting some of the immune response from the person who was already suffering it. And that just shows you how far we've come. Our vaccines are really not scary. They're not horrific like they were before, because no, I'm not gonna let a doctor put a scab under my skin. Yuck. So I know I've rambled a lot in this video. I feel very passionately about it. As a person who has gotten childhood diseases and has been very affected by them, I can't imagine having, you know, a baby contract those diseases and potentially die, or, you know, suffer long-term health issues. Because we don't have as much face-to-face interaction with people who are sick from these communicable diseases, we don't really understand what it is that we're vaccinating against. And that's why I put this video together, just to give you guys some information. I've listed all of my resources in the description below, so if you want to check on that, you can. I've also gone ahead and put my script into a WordPress post that's on my website, and I'll list that too, so that if you want to actually read it instead of just listening to me ramble, you can. You can see where I've gone off script a bit. But yeah, that's all I have for now. If you like this video, hit the thumbs up, and if you really liked it, hit the subscribe. I make new videos every Tuesday and Thursday, and I would love it if you would click the little bell so that you get notified every time I make one. If you disliked this video and you're gonna hit the dislike button, go ahead and hit it twice so I know you really mean it. And in the comments below, you can tell me if you've contracted any childhood diseases and if you had any side effects. Tell me what they are, and tell me how you feel about vaccinations. If you have a differing point of view, please, please, please let me know, but let's try to be friendly and kind to each other in the comments. So let's not call people idiots if they have a differing opinion. I feel like that's entirely unnecessary and not a good way to communicate. Because it's not. And I'll see you next time. Mwah. This is a very light video. This is a light video. This is a comedy. This is entertainment. People get sick and people die, and that is sad. Let's do a dance.